Peter and Judith met up with us in Skipton on Sunday the 2nd of May, and we went for a drive around the beautiful Wharfdale countryside in the Yorkshire Dales. We took a picnic with us, but the ground was so wet we had to eat it standing up. Afterwards we drove to Bolton Abbey. One of the reasons for visiting the Abbey was to pay our respects to two of our relatives, Aunt Edith Agnes and Aunt Mary Augusta. Actually, they're my first cousins twice removed and Judith's great aunts. Mary Augusta was awarded the MBE for her work in establishing the National Health Service. On our way back to the boat, we saw lots of newborn lambs frolicking around on the moors. After our day out, the four of us went on a late afternoon cruise into Upper Airedale. We moored up by the coal merchants in Gargrave and woke up to a fresh and crispy morning. We got away very early and continued cruising west through some spectacular scenery. It's easy to see why the surrounding area is designated the Yorkshire Dales National Park. We pulled over for a nice big fry-up breakfast as we made our way up a series of 10 locks. After these 6 Bank Newton locks, the canal snaked its way around green hills with lots of lambs jumping and skipping around. By now, Pat was an expert at handling a 60-foot narrowboat and had no problems negotiating the twists and turns. We cruised up to East Martin and had a pint at the Cross Keys and then began our 9-mile and 14-lot journey back to Skipton. We were all very tired by the time we moored up, but we introduced Peter and Judith to Busy Lizzie's before they took off back home to Holmforth. Once again, the fish and chips were first class. On Tuesday, we did our usual turnover duties. Laundry, pump out, refuel, replenish the Caligas, etc, etc. I spent the afternoon sanding down and touching up the minor scratches to the paintwork, while Pat went into town to restock our supplies. We lit the fire and had a nice quiet evening. Wednesday was market day and we had a good time strolling around the stalls. We said goodbye to Skipton in the late afternoon and cruised back to Gargrave with a newfound friend. We woke up on Thursday to the sound of bird songs. Spring is definitely here. Well, we knew what was ahead of us today, so we got an early start. We had a little panic attack when we got hooked up on the side of one of the locks. I guess this is as good a time as any to mention this. In doing this slideshow, 18 years after the cruise, I noticed that we always had our fenders dragging in the water. It makes much more sense to lift them out when you are cruising and only use them for protection when moored. Anyway, back to the commentary. We retraced our steps back to the Double Arch Bridge at East Martin and then started our cruise along one of the most remote areas of the Leeds and Liverpool Canal. And I should add, probably one of the most beautiful areas. Once again, you can be the judge. Here are a couple of shots we took as we travelled across the Pennine Highlands. The Pennine Way, a 250-mile walking route, shares the towpath for a short distance. We moored up in the middle of nowhere on Thursday night. It was so quiet and peaceful, nothing but the cow, sheep, birds and fish. We went for an evening walk and the fish were churning up the water in the reeds and the cows were wandering along the towpath. To make it even better, the weather was just near perfect. Today Pat planted flowers in one of our cauldrons, so now we have a roof garden. On the 7th of May we said goodbye to Yorkshire and hello to Lancashire. At Barnoldswick, locally known as Barlick, we stopped by Doug Moore's boatyard and bought an unpainted galvanised Buckby can. I'll show you Pat's finished product later on. A few miles beyond Barlick is the narrow 1,640-yard long Fowlridge Tunnel. It's one-way traffic and controlled by traffic lights. We moored by the northeastern portal, waited for the lights to turn green, and then headed into our first canal tunnel. We had our bow light on, but I didn't think about having a flashlight close at hand. About halfway through, I seemed to lose my equilibrium. It felt as though I was going downhill, and I started bouncing from side to side of the tunnel. Then came a terrible crunching and grinding noise, and unknown particles started to pepper my body. I've no idea why I didn't come to a stop. Maybe I thought the light at the end of the tunnel was my salvation. As we entered the bright sunlight, I could see that our chimney was a little worse for wear, and that a good part of Fowlridge Tunnel roof lay around me. Other than an attractive crease at the base of the chimney, no permanent damage was done, but we did learn another interesting rule of the canals. Remove the chimneys before entering a tunnel, and have a flashlight at the ready. After Fowlridge, we started leaving the beautiful high country behind us and descended the seven locks into Barrowford. That was our overnight stop. The next day, Saturday, we were not sure what to expect as we approached the towns of Nelson, Burnley and Blackburn. We were pleasantly surprised by the varied scenery that included open country, suburban communities and heavy industrial developments. Nelson is a typical Lancashire mill town, but for those into black magic, the nearby villages that were associated with the Pendle witch trials and the Brinnand family are most likely more intriguing. The 3/4 mile long Burnley embankment, or Burnley Vale as the old boatman used to call it, carries the canal 60 foot high through the town. A short distance beyond the embankment is one of the best 19th century industrial districts in the country, Weaver's Triangle, with its spinning mills, weaving sheds and terraced houses. Unfortunately, it was closed when we got there, so we didn't get to look around it. On our way to Burnley, we did what many people told us was a no-no. Three young lads were walking along the towpath and kept asking us for a ride. At first I said no, but after chatting with them for a while, I decided, oh, why not? They had never been on a narrowboat, and they were tickled pink when I said, okay, jump aboard. They were very polite and appreciative young men. By the way, this photo was taken as we crossed over the M65 motorway in Burnley. We stopped at Rishton around 1:30, where Peter and Judith stopped by to deliver our mail. The four of us had dinner at a nearby Indian restaurant, and it was good food and excellent service. On the way out, they handed Pat and Judith a red carnation. We left Rishton about 10 a.m. and the weather turned nasty, so we moored up early on the outskirts of Blackburn by a do-it-yourself store and a shopping area. That was very convenient. I spent a frustrating afternoon trying to install an aerial for the radio while Pat shopped and planted flowers in our second cauldron. While there, Narrowboat California cruised by us in pouring rain. I ran along the towpath and exchanged greetings with Mike and Bunny Goldsberg from Long Beach, California. I continued to work on the radio on Monday and we didn't get away until 4 o'clock in the afternoon. We only went through the six Blackburn locks before mooring up on the other side of town for the night. It looks like Pat's telling me that she wants to listen to the radio while she does the dishes. The weather turned nice and sunny as we cruised 8 miles beyond Blackburn to the attractive industrial hamlet of Withnall Fold with its village square and medieval stocks. With no one around, I asked Pat to place her legs in the stock so I could take a photo of her, and I accidentally flipped the catch over. It was difficult not to burst out laughing as I hid behind a tree and watched a school bus pull up. The disembarking kids looked in amazement at this strange woman apparently doing servitude for some heinous crime. Anyway, after making amends, we had a pleasant day cruising along and eventually moored in Hague Park near the top of the Wigan flight. On the way, we stopped at White Bear Marina and met Bill and Jane on narrowboat Cecil James. They told us that you had to book to go down the Wigan flight, so they kindly contacted British Waterways and made arrangements for the four of us to go down together tomorrow morning. On Wednesday, May the 12th, we were at the top lock at the appointed time of 8:30. We met up with Bill and Kate, and with the help of two British Waterways employees, had no problem as we descended the flight of 21 locks into the town of Wigan. We bid farewell to narrowboat Cecil James as Bill and Kate turned onto the lee branch of the Leeds and Liverpool, and we continued on into town. By noon we'd reached the famous Wigan Pier, a coal staith jutting out all of 2 feet into the canal. It was made fun of by ukulele player George Formby's father and immortalised by George Orwell in his book The Road to Wigan Pier. We spent a very enjoyable afternoon visiting the Way We Were Museum. It's located in the canal warehouses alongside the old Douglas Navigation Basin. It's an interesting exhibition about the local people's lifestyles during the first half of the 20th century. Afterwards, we took a short water bus trip over to the Treacherfield Mill to see the 2,500 horsepower steam engine with its 26-foot diameter flywheel that drives the mill's machinery. The noise level from just 4 spinning wheels running for a couple of minutes was deafening. When the mill was in full operation, they had over 100 wheels going all day long. We seriously thought about continuing on for the next 25 miles to the terminus at Liverpool, just so we could say that we cruised from one end of the canal to the other. But we decided against it. Likewise, we also chose not to go up the rougher branch to Tarleton. Looking back on our travels, I always regret not exploring these waterways. We did go on for a short distance to Gathurst, where we winded and moored up, and it was a long day. The next morning we made our way back through Wigan and had a bit of excitement. All of a sudden we came to a stop and drifted around in the middle of the canal. We picked up an assortment of ladies' garments around the propeller.